state of Hyderabad had a powerful and effective telecom system. The Nizams had their own postal service that printed stamps on par with the modern stamps wing of the British India. The first post office was set up in 1856. Stamps department in 1869. First telephone line came into being in 1885. Nizam radio found its voice in 1939. On the silver jubilee of Nizam VII's ascent to throne, the government distributed 20,000 radio sets to the people. Even in the field of education, Hyderabad had a unique place. Salar Jung promoted state-sponsored education. Nizam took it to a higher level. He had not just set up educational institutions here, but also made handsome donations to Aligarh Muslim University and Shantiniketan. By 1872, Hyderabad had 16 government-run schools. They taught Telugu, Urdu, Persian, English, Arabic and Marathi languages. Darul Ulum Oriental School, College, 1854. Hyderabad Civil Engineering College, 1869. Chadarghat High School, 1876. Chadarghat First Grade College, 1881. Alia Bada English School, 1879. Law School, 1899. Hyderabad Public School, 1913. Nizam College, 1886. Anglo-vernacular schools like City College, 1921, Mehboob College, 1882, AV College, 1944, Dharmavant School and College. There were several English medium schools of repute in Secunderabad. First English Public School, 1834, Roman Catholic School, 1835, St. Francis, 1850, St. Anne's, 1861, St. Mary's, 1885, William Barton, 1916, St. George Grammar School. Hyderabad was famed for its women's education. It was known as the city with most educated women. Pilgrami Girls' School, 1878, Nampally Girls' School, 1890, Stanley Girls' School, 1895, Mehboobia Girls' School and College, 1907, Non-Parda Methodist High School, 3 Girls Middle Schools, Janana School for Girls. Usmania University was the pride of Deccan. As the seat of higher learning, it shone bright in the whole country. It was the first university to teach in local language. Usmania University, 1917. In addition, Adi Hindu leader and Hyderabad's own Ambedkar Bhagiradi Verma had run over 30 schools for Dalits. The government in 1897 launched the scholarship scheme for the students intending to study in England. Sarojini Naidu, the Nightingale of India, studied in London thanks to Nizam's munificence. There were welfare hostels for the students. Reddy Hostels, 1920, Bachelor's Building. City was known for its progressive women. It was the venue for cultural and intellectual endeavors. To Niloufar, the youngest daughter-in-law of the Nizam, goes the credit of setting up Hyderabad Women and Children Welfare Society. Andhra Yuvati Mandali, 1935, Lady Hyderabad Club. Hyderabad had a robust medical and health system that helped its people weather pestilences like plague and cholera. This city was the first to think of specialty hospitals. This was the medical capital of Asia. Darul Shifa, 1581. Hakim Nizamuddin Clinic, 1630. Hyderabad Medical School, 1846. Edward Memorial Hospital, currently known to be Gandhi Hospital, 1851. Afzalganj Hospital, 1866. Jajgi Khana, 1889. Usmania General Hospital, 1925. Usmania Medical College, 1926. Victoria Janana and Children's Hospital. Residence Maternity Hospital. 2 TB Hospitals. Quarantine Hospital. Nilofer Hospital, 1953. Erragadda Mental Health Hospital, 1897. Chest Hospital. ENT Hospital. Scores of Ayurveda and Yunani Hospitals. It was in Hyderabad that Ronald Ross made his path-breaking researches in malaria. He is also the first one to get a Nobel in Asia. Fardumji, who worked in Residence Hospital, is the first woman anaesthetist. Hyderabad had no dearth of libraries and reading rooms. Mudigonda Shankaracharya Granthalayam, 1872. Asafia Library, 1890. Gunavardhak Library, 1895. Bollaram Reading Room, 1896. Bala Saraswati Library, 1895. Usmania Library. Sri Krishna Devarayandra Bhasha Nilayam, 1901. The government not just allocated funds for the libraries, but also recorded the new arrivals into the library. At the dawn of the 20th century, Hyderabad had its own power supply system. Hyderabad was home to the first ever electricity board in South India. By 1910, Hyderabad was producing power on the banks of Hussain Sagar. By 1913, electrical bulbs shone bright in Hyderabad. By 1930, it was the best electrified city in the country. The Madras state, of which the Andhra region was a part, could see the light of the day only in 1927. A good 17 years after Hyderabad had its electrical supply. The city of Hyderabad was known for its legal services. In fact, the Nizams were the first to demerge legal and administrative services. All the courts and prisons that we see today were built by the Nizams. High Court 1915 to 1919, City Civil Courts, Criminal Court, Darul Khaja Court, Atraf Balda Court, Chanchilguda Jail were built by the rulers of Hyderabad. Hyderabad was famed for its imposing administrative buildings. Assembly, 1905 to 1913. Secretariat, 1888. Raj Bhavan, Jubilee Hall, 1913. Rashtrapati Nilayam, 1860. These were built by the Nizams. Famed markets and mandis like Miralam Mandi, 1806, Mozunjahi Market, 1935, Monda Market, Lad Bazaar, Sultan Bazaar, Regimental Bazaar, General Bazaar. James Street and several others were built by the Nizams. It was a city of gardens, public gardens, Fateh Maidan, जिमखाना ग्राउंड्स, परेड ग्राउंड्स, पुराना पुल ब्रिज, मुस्लिम जंग ब्रिज, जामबाग, किशनबाग, फूलबाग, बशीरबाग एंड अ होस्ट ऑफ अदर गार्डन्स एंड ऑर्किड्स वर बिल्ट बाय द स्वेट एंड ब्लड ऑफ तेलंगानाइट्स। My city was the city of lakes, an impregnable water storehouse dotted by myriad lakes. The heart-shaped Hussain Sagar, which is in the heart of the city, was a freshwater lake. Mir Alam Tank was built with the technical expertise of the French engineers. Usman Sagar and Himayat Sagar served as both drinking water sources to the city as well as balancing reservoirs to prevent Musi floods. These lakes and water bodies ensured that Hyderabadis were never parched for water. Hussain Sagar, 1562. Mir Alam Tank, 1804 to 1806. Osman Sagar, 1920. Himayat Sagar, 1927. Hyderabad had its own currency. The State Mint Department had minted its own currency, first as Hali Sikka and then the Usmania Sikka. The Department of Mint and the State Printing Press were set up as far back as in 1856. The Nizam Observatory, set up in 1908, had two massive telescopes, a seismograph and a slew of modern scientific equipment. It was a center of research and had published technical journals of great repute. Hyderabad was a cosmopolitan city from times immemorial. Marwadis, Gujaratis, Kannadigas, Rajasthanis, Tamil, Kayasths and a host of other communities found a safe haven and secure home in Hyderabad. They loved this city, and the city gave back love and gifted them with progress unparalleled. Persians, Afghans, Siddhis, Europeans, Pathans and Rohillas from far-off lands migrated to Hyderabad and became fully integrated with everything Hyderabadi. Hyderabad thus is a confluence of cultures from far and wide. This is a city of imposing and eye-arresting monuments known for cool and cozy comfort. They were as aesthetic as they were exquisite. They made this a truly monumental city. Hyderabad was a city of monuments. Falaknuma, Chow Mahalla, King Koti Palace, Bashirbagh Palace and Paiga Palace. Bhagyanagar wore these architectural jewels like a blushing bride. Itinerants and adventurers who came to the city were mesmerized by its exquisite beauty and sang paeans to it. They gleefully recollected its architectural elegance and infrastructural excellence. Hyderabad grew into an elegant urban habitation during Qutub Shahis and evolved into a world-famed city during the Asif Jahi reign. The world looked at in wonder and awe. With its amenities and beauties, with its salubrious atmosphere and modern facilities, and its rulers who were the richest and most famous, Hyderabad state was among the best in the world. It made international news every day. When the Nawabs of Hyderabad had gone to London, the camera flash lights vied with one another to record their visits for posterity. The city and its royalty were page 3 stuff for the whole world, much, much before the idea of page 3 evolved. That is Hyderabad for you. For Hyderabad, November 1st, 1956 was the darkest day. The formation of Andhra Pradesh was a subterfuge, a tragedy unbound. The city saw nothing but systematic destruction and systematic neglect during the 5.5-decade Andhra rule. Did they build a single railway station in Hyderabad in the last 55 years? Was a new hospital built? Was a single new college built? The same saga of falsehoods and innuendo continues in case of investments and demography. They make false claims that there are up to 40 lakh Seemantrites in Hyderabad. But the fact is they are never more than 4 lakhs. Even the Sri Krishna Committee report, which did the Andhrite bidding, said the Seemantra population is no more than 7% in Hyderabad. The Andhrite cacophony was blaring ad nauseam that half the investments in Hyderabad are theirs. The truth? Not is 1% of investments are theirs. The numbers speak for themselves. Most of their assets are illegal, and it is to protect them that they are blabbering on and on. It is this urge to grab every resource in Hyderabad that is making them to come up with wild and outrageous demands like UT status and common capital. This is nothing but a sadistic yearning propelled by desire to deny to us what they cannot lay their hands on.